No la creel. New word for the day. No la creel. If you say it in Japanese, it's Merry Christmas. Because they don't have a word for it. The first one is Scottish Gaelic. I learned that last night because I didn't know how to say it. And I was just like, I've been trying to come up with a new way to say Merry Christmas every time I stand up here and teach everybody a new language, because everybody knows Feliz Navidad. So everybody knows Merry Christmas. So good morning. Welcome to Travis Baptist this morning. This is the third Sunday in Advent, the Sunday of joy. And so let's go ahead and stand as we sing Angels from the Realms of Glory, and as the deacons bring forth the banner in the reading.
Angels from the realms of glory, wing your flight o'er all the earth. Ye who sang creation's story, now proclaim Messiah's birth. Come and worship, come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King. Shepherds in the fields abiding, watching o'er your flocks by night. God with men is now residing, yonder shines the infant light. Come and worship, come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King.
Scripture reading for this morning, John 3:16 through 18. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved.
He who believes in him is not condemned, but he who does not is condemned already.
Because he does not believe in the name of the only begotten Son of God.
Amen.
Let's pray together. Our Lord and our God, we thank you so much that you've loved us so much you would send us your Son. And today, as we continue remembering that and celebrating it, let that beautiful message be on our lips that Jesus Christ came to save sinners, that eternal life comes only through him. And that indeed is why Christmas took place. Lord, we pray that that message will be bold and clear. We pray that there are some here today whose hearts are struggling, whose have been enduring some hardship, and today they might find some hope in you, some hope in your beautiful message of Christmas. We ask you, God, to restore that joy of our salvation. We get so caught up in the stresses and the expectations of the holiday season, we forget to rejoice with exceeding great joy that Jesus Christ has come. And we even more joy, Lord, that one day he'll come again. So remind us, Lord, strengthen us, and help us walk through these days boldly confident in you. We say all these things in the name of your Son, Christ. Amen. Thank you, and you can be seated. We thank the deacons for doing the procession this morning. And we're going to have a little bit of different service today. So one thing is we've got the offering plate sitting on the side and in the back. So when you get a chance at any point during the service, feel free to drop your offering or your information card in there. We would greatly appreciate that at any point during the service. So we just leave that up to you. But we do have a special service today, so just stick with us. We're going to be doing a few things different, and I think God will bless through all of this. We also, this evening, we've got deacons meeting at 5 o'clock, and then we've got a business meeting at 6:30. At the business meeting, we've got the 2024 budget and also a report from the real estate team. So we need you here for that. That'll be at 6:30 in this very room. And keep that in mind. Awana is going to have their last meeting of the year this Wednesday at 6:20. And so come join us for that. The adult Bible study prayer meeting. We are on hiatus until January, okay? So we're done for now on the adult end of that. But Awana will be having their group on this Wednesday. Do remember next Sunday morning, we've got Sunday school at 9:30 and we've got worship at 10:45. Then at 6 o'clock p.m., we will be having our candlelight Christmas Eve service. So please keep that on your calendar. Remember to join us also on Christmas Eve, 6 p.m. We would love to have you, your family, your friends, to have a worshipful time together, remembering that night that Christ was born. So keeping all those things in mind, I want to remind you also, we have the little flap on our bulletin cover. For those of you that are our guests for the first time or the first time in a long time, or if you need to update your address, email, phone number, anything like that, you can use this, tear it right off, drop it in the offering plates at any time you wish, and we would appreciate you doing that. In a moment, we're going to go around and welcome one another, but as we're doing that, because of the nature of the service, we're going to dismiss the ones that want to go up to Children's Church. We're going to dismiss you during the welcome time. So at whatever point you want to send your kids out there, go ahead, okay? So let's go ahead and welcome one another into the Lord's house. Oh, wait, stop. I'm sorry. I skipped the Lottie Moon video. Okay, sit back down. I'm sorry. You can't leave yet, kids. All right. Each December, we remember our international missionaries. Just as God crossed the universe to come be with us, so also we remember in Christ coming to bring us this gospel around the globe. And so we have a video to remind you. We've already hit our goal of 1,500. We're into 1,800 and something. So let's get on up into the 2,000s, if you would. But let's watch this to be encouraged about what God is doing around the world.
I want to thank the churches of the Southern Baptist Convention for sending your missionaries and your support to Ukraine. I came to know Jesus Christ because of a Southern Baptist missionary. I began to grow as a Christian because of a Southern Baptist missionary. And we have served with the missionaries from the IMB over all these years. I planted my church. I was ordained in this church with a missionary from the IMB ordaining me. And right now, when the war in Ukraine began, my wife, she had to walk across the border from Ukraine into Romania. And the first people who met her on that other side were our dear friends from the IMB. They were able to welcome her, to give her a hug, to give her a hot cup of tea, and to send her further. Thank you for your support. Thank you for your generosity. Thank you for your prayers. And thank you for your presence with us around the world. God bless you abundantly.
So any offerings marked with missions, or you can use the special missions offering envelope that's in the pew in front of you, will go towards that goal, okay? We are supporting, as we learned last week, over 3,500 missionaries around the world that resulted in over 120,000 baptisms in 2022. We want to see God's kingdom continue to spread, okay? Amen. So now, again, children, you're going to be dismissed to go up to Children's Church. The rest of us, if you want to welcome one another to church, we can do that now. Morning. How are you?
My daughter's going to sing it.
Hi. How are you?
Australia said she can't come to my birthday party. Saturday.
Uh-huh.
Wonderful.
Okay.
Well, you feel welcome.
I think I can. Okay.
She said you might want to.
Yeah.
She's going to have kids.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And maybe want to.
Okay. Good morning. How are you doing today? Good. Everybody abandon you?
Yeah, we go to
Okay. Yeah, okay. Oh, wow. Yeah. Yeah, because it was due the early January, so goodness. Okay. All right. Yeah. Yeah. Hey there, good morning. How are you? Okay. Oh, okay. Yeah. Hey, Javier, how are you?
Good.
Hi.
How are you doing?
Awesome. You're welcome.
Hey, how are y'all doing? I'm David.
Hello.
Howdy. How are you, sir? Oh, morning. How are you? Good. Let's see. Howdy. How are you? Morning. Hey, how you doing? Oh, excuse me. Hey there, Richard.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas. Oh, morning.
Make it back to our places. As we make it back, we're going to stand and we're going to sing, O Come, Emmanuel. And please be seated as Mary makes her way up.
Your music's right here.
Oh, he put it here. Okay.
We're going to be reading our whole service kind of based off of John 3:16-18, and we read it a few minutes earlier. For God so loved the world that he sent his only son. Our God has a loving heart above all else, and in that love he sent his son. Now think for a minute. When you go to court in someone, when you go to try and getting them to fall in love with you, what do? You make a plan. You plan to get them flowers, you plan a candlelight dinner, you plan dates, you plan other things that we could finally get together and grow to love each other. God, in the same way, did not leave it up to chance, his love relationship with us. But he had a plan to send his son. And in that plan, it was always there. His birth becomes such a major event that there's dozens of prophecies about it in the Old Testament, that a Messiah would come, that God from the beginning, even in Genesis chapter 3, when he told the devil, your seed and her seed will always be at each other's throats, be enemies with each other. But one day her seed is going to come and you might bruise his heel, but he's going to bruise your head. And in that prophecy, we see the very beginning that one would come from a woman that would defeat the devil, that would come, and that this happened way back in Genesis and even before, as we learn that God plans things before the foundations of the earth. We never catch God by surprise. He has never allowed chaos to rule. It might look like that from our standpoint. But this crazy thing of Joseph and Mary, her coming up pregnant, having never known a man, and then suddenly having to go to Bethlehem, several dozen miles away. Why? Because suddenly Caesar wants to tax everybody, and they got to go to their husband's hometown where his family's from. That was no accident. It was all planned out, just like we see in a prophecy in the book of Micah, chapter 5, verse 2. You, Bethlehem Ephrathah. That word Ephrathah was just kind of a second name for Bethlehem, kind of the area it was in at the time. But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are little among the thousands of Israel, yet out of you shall come forth to me the one to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth are from of old, from everlasting. Let that passage dwell in a minute. God sent his son. He loved us so much he sent his son. When did he decide to do that? Just one Christmas? You know what? I think it'd be a good idea to give them a savior. No. Micah prophesied probably 400 years before Christ was born. But yet God had a plan even before then. Look at the end of this passage. His goings forth are from of old, from everlasting. This Messiah who would come goes back to the dawn of eternity. He goes all the way back because he is God the Son. The Father, Son, the Holy Spirit, all three are God. All three are equal. All three are eternal. Three persons, one essence. We don't understand all of it, but we do know this. Jesus was not a surprise on anybody. Amen. He was planned. Why? Because God loved us, so he sent him. He didn't stumble in. He didn't accidentally wind up here. He was sent. Amen. Because of God's loving heart. Because from the beginning he saw that we had rebelled against him. From the beginning he saw that we turned away from him. That the sin that Adam and Eve committed would get into our gene pool and affect us all through history. And just take a look around you, every one of us. If left to our own devices, if mama and daddy hadn't taught us different, or if there weren't laws and teachers and others who would hold us accountable, boy, when we're left to our own devices to do whatever we want, what kind of trouble can we get ourselves into? What kind of damage, what kind of evil can we cause? But God said, no, that's not the life I want for you. I love you so much that I'm going to have a plan to send my son, that whosoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life, to give you hope for eternity. That loving heart of God then sent his son, that one in Bethlehem who is to be our ruler, whose goings forth are from of old, from everlasting. It's him we worship, and it's him we look forward to. Each and every one of us, that son has come for us to tell us that God loves us enough to make us part of his family. So as we anxiously accept Jesus, we sing and worship him until he does come again.
Join with me singing, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus.
would one day walk on water. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered would soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm the storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? And when you kiss your little baby, you've kissed the face of God. Oh, Mary, did you know? Oh, Mary, did you know? The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak, the praises of the Lord. Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy was heaven's perfect lamb? And the sleeping child you're holding is the great I Am. He's the great I Am. Oh, Mary, did you know?
Said the night wind to the little lamb, do you see what I see? Way up in the sky, little lamb, do you see what I see? A star, dancing in the night with a tail as big as a kite. With a tail as big as a kite. Said the little lamb to the shepherd boy, do you know what I know? Ringing through the sky, shepherd boy, do you hear what I hear? A song, high above the tree with a voice as big as the sea. With a voice as big as the sea. Amen. Said the shepherd boy to the mighty key, do you know what I know? In your palace warm, mighty king, do you know what I know? A child shivers in the cold. Let us bring him silver and gold. let us bring him silver and gold. Said the king to the people everywhere, listen to what I say. Pray for peace, people everywhere, listen to what I say. The child, sleeping in the night, he will bring us goodness and light. He will bring us goodness and light.
All right. Thank you, ladies. And as we continue in our message here, we continue thinking about God's heart and that God has, in fact, a broken heart. Why would we say God has a broken heart? Well, it tells us there in this passage, God so loved, he's loving, that he sent his only begotten Son, that whosoever should believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. But then we look at the next verse. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world. That's wonderful. We don't need to be condemned. Here's the problem, though. God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might through him be saved. What are we saying? God's heart is broken, is that not because the Son is coming to save us, but the fact that we needed to be. You see, the world was already condemned. God's heart was broken because man had rebelled against him. We have been separated from him. His heart is broken because we have rejected him. We are separated from him. We don't maintain our relationship with him. And God describes the person that doesn't know him, that doesn't walk with him, that doesn't believe with him in him. God describes that person as dead. We are dead in our sins. We are so far separated from God, it's like we don't even have a life as far as he's concerned. And this is what's hard for us to understand. From God's standpoint, if you don't have him, you're a dead man walking, a dead lady just wandering around. But with him, we're made alive. With him, we have the life that was promised to us. The abundant life, the joyful life, the life that's of a clean conscience, the life of someone who, despite their past, despite their failures, has the confidence of knowing that they are loved and that they belong in the kingdom of God. God describes our lostness as walking in darkness. And as we mentioned in the Old Testament, many times he talks about that Messiah who would come. His heart was broken because we needed a Messiah. Because of the world we're walking in. In Isaiah chapter 9, verse 2, he says, the people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in the land of the shadow of death, upon them a light has shined. This is how God sees our life. No matter what, if we're in the great old USA or anywhere else on this planet, we are living in the land of the shadow of death. Because that's what awaits every one of us, no matter how rich, how poor you are, that is what awaits. We are living in a world of darkness. Why do we have war? Why do we have injustice? Why do we have cruelty? Why do we have so many obnoxious, obscene, terrible stories of what people do to each other in our newscasts? Because we are evil when you get right down to it. Well, not us, Pastor. Well, maybe not us, but this world around us surely is. How many times have good, innocent, decent people been the victims of tragedy, of monsters that walk among us? God says we dwell in the land of the shadow of death. But there's a light that shines. There is hope. Because God, in looking at our broken world, even there in the garden with that first disobedience, even perhaps before creation, he knew that if he created beings with a free will, they would eventually disobey him. That loving heart drove him to do it, but that broken heart also drove him to action. He didn't send Christ to condemn the world because the world was already condemned. He sent him to save us.
He brought Christmas not just so we could have presents, not just so we could love one another. That's a good thing to do in the name of Jesus Christ. But above all else, He sent Him to deal with our sin problem. To deal with our separation problem. That baby, that vulnerable child lying in the manger, was going to save us. As Mary looked down and kissed, did she know that that was the very face of God? Did she know that that child would walk on water, that one day that child she delivered would deliver her? Well, God told us, yes, He would. His heart was broken so much, He decided to take action. That loving heart say, if I'm broken, if we've got a problem, I'm going to take action. So God took action. And glory be, instead of asking us to make up for what we had done in our helplessness, moved by the broken heart, God sent His Son. Not to condemn, but to save. And this is why He died such a gruesome, brutal death. It's so hard to think that little baby, and we've all experienced that. We look at that child when we first receive them, and they're so innocent, so clean. We don't want to think about how when they turn 12, 13, 14 years old, they're going to frustrate us real bad. And by the time they're 17 and 18, they're making decisions, and we're going, what is this knucklehead thinking? But we go through life, and we realize we all make the mistakes. We all make bad decisions, and someone has to pay for that. There are consequences to our actions, but ultimately God sent His Son to pay for those consequences. He died that brutal, suffering death because sin is brutal and evil and gruesome. When we look at pictures from the movie of the Passion of the Christ, and we see what that crown of thorns really would have done, it wouldn't just been a couple drops of blood down His forehead, it would have been gushing. When we see what that whip really would have done to Him, not just a couple of stripes back there, but turned His back into hamburger. When we see that those nails through the hands wouldn't just leave little wounds. Oh my, it would cause spasms up and down His arms. The blood would come pouring. The pressure on His chest as He hung there would suffocate Him. As He pushed up to alleviate that suffering, He's pushing up against the nails in His feet that have broken every bone in both feet, maybe His ankles too. To think the amount of suffering that Jesus Christ went through, this is how broken God's heart was, because all of our sin, of all history, He became sin for us. This pure one who never did a thing wrong, this holy one of Israel who never committed a sin, suddenly absorbed all of ours upon that cross. He sent His only begotten Son that whosoever believes in Him would not perish, but have everlasting life. This was the price it took to pay for that. It's God's heart breaking to the point that He actually sent darkness at a point in time during Jesus being upon that cross where Jesus cries out, my God, why have You forsaken Me? What about My baby pictures? What about when I was small and vulnerable? Remember how adorable I was? Why have You turned Your back on Me? Your only Son. But that's what our sin did. And it must have broken His heart all over again to have to turn away in those moments, because He cannot stand to look upon that which is evil. Jesus was not evil, but with all our guilt laid upon Him, He became sin for us. Amen. And there we have it. The ugly part of Christmas. The part we don't want to think about. Christmas is all pretty and clean. We got our beautifully flocked trees and our lovely silver and gold decorations, and we got our red and our green on, and we're all just happy, and it's beautiful, and we spend a lot of money on it, and it's all wonderful. But let's remember, the end of that story is a bloody one. I mean, Herod himself, so offended that another who claims to be the king of the Jews would be born, he heads to that town with his soldiers to wipe out everybody who's old enough to have been born in that time period. Let's not think about that on Christmas, Pastor. That's where the three kings came in, the three magi. Folks, it was a bloody thing that Jesus had to go through.
because we walked in such darkness. That light of the world came, though, willingly. And that light is shining upon us. And we need to rejoice because that light does shine. As He looks down from heaven on us this morning, as He looks down upon the struggle you're going through, He is saying to you, I also paid a price for you. Paid a price for you to heal up all that brokenness. Jesus came to heal the broken of all of us, to be broken Himself. But He did it for our healing.
Did it feel like a night any different than at least a million before? Was there any rare expectation, like there was some kind of something in store? Did the sky have to hold back the thunder? Did the moon find new reasons to glow? Could the children somehow sense the wonder 2,000 Decembers ago? Were the sheep just as mazed as the shepherds at the new star that lit up the sky? Did the willow trees whisper excitement to the rivers and streams passing by? Did the joy ricochet off the mountains till it filled up the valleys below? Did all of the world sense love abounding 2,000 Decembers ago? Was anyone able to look at the stable and not see a child but a king? I wish I could hear back over the years as heaven and angels sing. Heaven and angels sing. Did the walls of the barn start to tremble contain? Did anyone wake with the feeling of peace that they could not explain? Oh, the love must have been overwhelming as it warmed everyone in its flow. For all of the world is still telling of 2,000 Decembers ago. Was anyone able to look at the stable and not see a child but a king? I wish I could hear back over the years as heaven and nature sing. Was anyone able to look at the stable and not see a child but a king? I wish I could hear back over the years as heaven and nature sing. Heaven and nature sing. Heaven and nature sing. Oh, the love must have been overwhelming.
Yeah.
shining. It is the night of the dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees, O hear the angel voices, O night divine, O night when Christ was born, O night, dear holy night, O night divine. Truly he taught us to love one another. His law is love, and his gospel is peace. Chains shall he break, for the slave is our brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease. Sweet hymns of joy in grateful chorus raise we, let all within us praise his holy name. Christ is the Lord, oh praise his name forever. Proclaim his power and glory evermore. Proclaim.
Amen. And so now we see that God had a loving heart to send us his son. He made a plan. He had a broken heart, but he made a provision in his son Christ. And then we see God has a missionary heart. We talk about that during our Lottie Moon month for international missions, God's love for people everywhere. And God did what it took. He crossed the sky for our love. He came from heaven to that manger. He left a throne for a feed trough. He did that, why? So that you and I, whosoever would believe in him, would not perish. That Holy One from heaven. How does this happen? How does this happen that God would love us so much that God the Son would be willing to leave that throne and come among us? The hope that God gives, the provision he provides, the Son that has come. How does this, what motivates him? And we look in and we see another prophecy about him, right in the same book of Isaiah chapter 9, just a few verses down from the last place we read. And we read this. Remember how we talked about that light shined on the people walking in darkness? Then it comes, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. And the government will be upon his shoulders. And his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And a lot of times we love those words. Because look at it for a minute. What is God's solution for all this? His missionary heart was that a son would come. A child would be given. Given as a sacrifice. His life would be one to pay the price for us. But what child is this? The government, it says his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor. His name is Wonderful. Above all names, Counselor. He possesses all knowledge. He knows exactly what to do. Not only is his name Wonderful and Counselor, it's Mighty God. Amen. We read in James chapter 1 a great Christmas message. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And we drop down to verse 14, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father. Mighty God he is. That this Jesus is not just a good teacher, but it was God encased in flesh. And then this next one, Everlasting Father. I thought he was the Son. Yeah. But the idea here is not only is he eternal, he's going to be the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords and the Prince of Peace. This phrase, Everlasting Father, as it applies to the Son, is speaking of his authority that's going to be granted to him by the Father. The way it looks is this. Basically, God the Father grants to God the Son the family business, handing over the keys to the universe in a sense, saying to him, sit here at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. This is our King Jesus, the Prince of Peace, the only one who can bring peace. This holy child that God has given. And we talk a lot about those names, but I want us to back it up a little bit. The government will be upon his shoulders. What does that mean? Well, our government, we really are kind of look at our government leaders with kind of a jaundiced eye, don't we? Are they really in there for our benefit and our good, or are they in there to turn themselves into millionaires? Are they honest, good people seeking the best for our city, our county, our state, our country? Or are they kind of looking out for number one? We look around the world and we see tyrants and we see kings and we see prime ministers. Are they all really seeking the best of the people? We wonder sometimes, don't we? And in all honesty, we have our doubts about it. We're all old enough. We want to vote. We want to be good patriots. But we long for the day of leaders we can trust in and believe in. But with that phrase, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, this is the idea. If you're a sports fan, you often hear about a player who picks the team up on his shoulders and carries them. He just takes responsibility for the victory. This indeed is what it's saying about Jesus. The government, the rulership of this world, right and wrong and all of that, Jesus is going to put it all on his shoulders. And he's going to carry us. And he's going to carry it through. He's taking responsibility. You and I, as we mentioned, under a broken heart, we are broken. We are failed. We are separated. We are hopeless. But the light shined in the darkness. And what is that light? That unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. Not just any son. This son is Mighty God, Prince of Peace, Everlasting Father. He's the Wonderful Counselor. He is the be-all to end-all. He is God, Lord Almighty, coming among us. Vulnerable like a baby, encased in human flesh. Powerful enough to calm a storm, to make people wonder what kind of guy is this? Raising the dead, the sick, the blind, the crippled. Speaking the word, and it is so. Whether it be calming the storm or causing the blind to see. And he's the one with that human flesh volunteering to die for us, to suffer in that flesh. The night before his crucifixion, Jesus was in Gethsemane sweating blood over the stress of what was about to occur the next day. Why? Because he was going to take responsibility, the sins of the whole world laid upon his shoulders. Just as he entered this world as a helpless, vulnerable child, he surrenders himself. Nobody took his life from him. He surrendered it. He surrendered to the authorities when they came to arrest him. He surrendered
to the soldiers whipping him. He surrendered to the nails in his feet and his hands as he died upon that cross. A passage in the New Testament reminds us, though, inasmuch then as the children, that's me and you, have partaken of flesh and blood, we're flesh and blood. He himself, this is Jesus, likewise shared in the same. He took on flesh and blood, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is, the devil. You see, Christmas is about that right there. Just like we're flesh and blood, God the Son took on flesh and blood through the Virgin Mary, vulnerable, able to die, and he does die. But in doing so, he destroys him who had the power of death, that is, the devil. Because in doing so, God sent his only Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but what? Have everlasting life. He's destroyed that power of death. He didn't come to condemn the world. He came to save it, that through him the world might be saved. Now we come to verse 18, and he who believes in him is not condemned. Though the world is condemned, if you have said, I believe in you, Jesus. I believe you died on the cross for my sins. You rose from that grave on the third day. I believe you are not condemned. You have been saved. But if you choose not to believe, you're condemned already. Why? Why am I already condemned? Because God did everything he could. He put the government upon his shoulders. He crossed the galaxy. He took the responsibility. He came to give you every way possible. It is not up to you to make up for the past, to make your bad go away. He took the punishment for you. And in so doing, you're not condemned. If you believe it. The world tells you it's impossible, a man who lived 10,000, 2,000 Decembers ago, that he could possibly do anything about your present condition. The world tells you there's no way he could rise from the dead after dying the death that he did. The world tells you you're just going to turn back to dust when you die. But the Lord says, whosoever believes in him shall not perish. They are not condemned. The ones who are condemned are those who don't believe. Condemned already. You were born condemned. But he didn't come to condemn you. He came to save you. Would you believe in him? Inasmuch in as we are flesh and blood, he became flesh and blood. That through death, he might destroy him that has the power of death. That is the devil. Boy, the next verse talks about those of us who've lived with the fear of death hanging over us, to free us from that. It's beautiful. That's Christmas, the greatest gift of all. That we don't have to fear death. We've buried a few here lately. A good friend of mine who used to be the executive director of the Corpus Christi Association, Nansen Nash. We had his memorial service yesterday. We remembered him. We glorified God for all he did through him. And thank God that as his wife and his family grieve, they don't have to grieve as others do. Why? Because Jesus has destroyed the power of death. There is resurrection for all of us who believe. There is resurrection for you. What have I got to do? What you got to do is celebrate Christmas. Come to that manger and realize that's your Savior. That he has come vulnerable as a baby, vulnerable to death. And he suffered that death. So lay down your pride, your vanity, your arrogance that makes you think you can do it on your own. And let God alone be high. Let God alone be king. Let the Lord Jesus Christ be your Savior. To say to him, as I look upon that manger, I can't believe this, Lord. Someone as frail as you grew up with the power, with the embodiment of God to be able to save me. And you did it in the weakest way possible by submitting to the death of a murderer, the death of a thief, the death of a terrorist, the death of all deaths. You suffered it. Amen. And then remember that little chorus we sing around here once in a while. I'm forgiven because you were condemned.
Amen.
I'm accepted. You were rejected. I'm alive and well, and your spirit lives within me because you died and rose again. The glory of that statement, the truth of that song, that's the message of Christmas. That it all started right there. That light shined in the darkness for all of us who live without hope. That light then resulted in being a son is given, a child is born. Not just any child, but the wonderful counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. That He took on flesh. That just like we're flesh, He died for us and destroyed the power of Him who has the power of death, that is the devil. Oh, look at it. This is God's gift to you. That's why He sent His Son. That's why we celebrate Christmas every year, and it's a good thing we do. I'm glad Jesus came. A child like that, born in the manner He was, to carry out the mission He had. That child, what kind of child was he? Oh, a very special child. A wonderful counselor, a mighty God. An everlasting Father and a Prince of Peace.
What child is this who laid to rest on Mary's lap and sleeping, whom angels greet with handsome sweet, while shepherds watch or keep it, while lies he in such mean a state, where ox and ass are feeding. Good Christian, fear for sinners here these silent word is pleading. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds watch and angels sing. This is Christ the King, the babe, the Son of Mary. God sent His Son, they call Him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He came to die, to warn my victory, and life is just because He knows my Christ He lives, because can face tomorrow because he lives. All fear is gone because I know he holds my future.
And what more fitting congregational sing after that? Join me with Good Christian Men Rejoice.
Good Christian men rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Give it to what we say. Jesus Christ was born to stay. Ox and ass before him bow, and he is in the manger now. Christ was born today. Christ was born today. Good Christian men rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Now ye hear of endless bliss. Jesus Christ was born for this. He has opened heaven's door, and man is blessed forevermore. Christ was born for this. Christ was born for this. Good Christian men rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Now ye need not fear the grave. Jesus Christ was born to save. Calls you one and calls you all to gain his everlasting hall. Christ was born to save. Christ was born to save.
Amen. Mm. You can be seated. We do this to get the message across. Amen. Hopefully we hammered it home real good that Jesus Christ, born that Christmas day, was God the Son.
That's right.
Who grew up a sinless life to die for us. That he sent his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes him would not perish but have everlasting life. Sent not to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. And, and he that believes in him is not condemned, but he that believes not is condemned already. I hope that's not you. We want to have a brief moment of invitation. Maybe you're starting to realize, maybe I've never really dealt with Jesus. I've never really spoken to him. I've never really given my heart to him. I've never really believed. Today could be that day. We're going to sing a song in a moment, and hopefully it'll encourage you and maybe opening your heart up to the fact that right here, right now, just saying to him, Lord Jesus, I never understood, but today I do. And I believe that you died for my sins and rose from the grave. Those simple words like that, the Bible says, if you believe, if you'll confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. So it's not a long, drawn-out process. It's you saying, starting today, Lord, yes, I'm following you. I believe. Is that you? Let's pray for a moment, and then we're going to sing. And while we're singing, if that's you, I want to come and pray with you, okay? Father, I love you, and we thank you for all that you've done today. And we pray that if there's any heart here that doesn't know you, if there's anyone here who's not confident of their that they're going to be in heaven with you for all eternity, that they take this time to step forward and say, Pastor, pray with me about this. Pray that I might come to Christ. Lord, we pray for them. Ask you to open the door for them and help them to believe.
And Lord, we pray for each one here that as we go our separate ways today, you'll bless them, watch over them. Keep this message of Christmas in our hearts. We pray these things in the name of Christ. Amen. Amen. So we're going to sing, Come Ye Sinners, Poor and Needy, right now. And if that's you, if you're someone who's saying, yes, I need to be sure, I've never really dealt with this before like I ought to, come this morning. Come while we're singing. Let me pray with you, all right? Let's all stand as we sing.
Come ye sinners, poor and needy, weak and wounded, sick and sore. Jesus ready stands to save you, full of pity, love and power. I will arise and go to Jesus. He will embrace me.
Believe that he died upon the cross for your sins, and you believe that God raised him on the third day. All right, then say from your heart, Father in heaven, I believe that Jesus Christ died for me, and I know that I could never be in your family without him. I am a sinner who needs you. And I believe that you raised him from the grave on the third day.
I will arise
and that you, Lord, come into my heart.
He will embrace me.
Amen. The Word of God says, Vivian, that as many as receive him, he gives the power to become the children of God, okay? So you keep believing and you keep coming back, okay? Father, be with Vivian and help her to understand. We pray these things in the name of Christ. Amen.
Make you linger, pause and
back where you were sitting, and we'll try and talk to you more. And like I said, if you can come back Wednesday or something, I don't know what your schedule is, but we can talk more, okay?
I will arise and go to Jesus. He will embrace me in his arms, in the arms of my dear Savior. Oh, there are 10,000 charms. Come ye weary, heavy laden, lost and ruined by the fall. If you tarry till you're better, you will never come at all. I will arise and go to Jesus. He will embrace me in his arms, in the arms of my dear Savior. Oh, there are 10,000 charms.
Before the prayer, I would just like a big hand of applause for our piano players, Patty and Lori, and all our singers this morning. Beautiful. The year is coming to an end, and our staff, our church staff, Our pastors, David, Associate Pastor Kurt, have done a wonderful job throughout the year. And so don't forget the love offerings, and just designate it on your cards, and what goes to the budget, and what goes to that, okay? Let us pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord God, we are so blessed to be in your house this morning, to praise you, to worship you, to glorify your name. I pray for forgiveness for my sins, Lord. And just bless our congregation, bless everyone in attendance. Bless those members who are not here today because there are other concerns, they're traveling. Those that are traveling, keep them safe. Get them home safely. Those that have medical concerns, Lord God, be with them. Those that have lost a loved one, Lord God, be with them throughout the coming days. And we just pray for our first responders throughout our great nation. They are there to protect us. We pray for our military stationed throughout the world, men and women. Get them home safely. We pray for their families during their long separations. And we pray, Lord God, that peace will come to the Ukraine and that peace will come to Israel. And we ask these things in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.